This is the one console I wasn't going to own for the 9th generation of gaming. Not because it's a bad piece of gear, this chunk of plastic is arguably the best home console of the generation. But since there are no Xbox exclusives, only Microsoft exclusives, if you have a big schmeckled PC rig, it makes more sense to have a $300 budget banger Xbox Series S in the living room or bedroom to carry on your game progress from Game Pass. And as it shares most of the key features, such as 120fps gaming and instant load times with an SSD, unless you need 12.1 cornea scorching teraflops of graphical power, the Xbox Series S makes a lot of sense. And if you want timeless classics like Mario, Zelda, Pokemon, and Metroid, as well as multiplayer party games and AAA experiences on the go, you're gonna have yourself a Switch. And since Sony doesn't port their amazing exclusives for 2 to 3 years, if at all, it makes sense to grab the awesome DualSense controller and turn on the PlayStation 5. I pre-ordered a Valve Steam Deck because you can do PC things on the go, like changing operating systems and using multiple launchers. And we've never had this degree of PC performance in a Switch-like form factor, with buttons on the back, trackpads, dual analog sticks, and linear triggers. However, my gaming life simply wasn't complete. I fell into a deep downward spiral and my diet started consisting of nothing but mayonnaise popsicles. I realized what I needed in my life was a big, thick, black console in my entertainment center, stuffing it, filling it with Microsoft and Bethesda experiences. The Xbox Series X is an amazing piece of gaming gear and, you know, content, bro. There's no denying that the Xbox Series S is an absolute beast of modern gaming with 12.1 teraflops of graphical power in comparison to the PlayStation 5's 10.3 and the anemic 4 on the Xbox Series S. However, I do want to quickly point out that there are only two features on this box that the $300 budget banger Xbox Series S cannot do. The first one is 4K gaming at 120 frames per second, while the Series S is targeting upscaled 1440, 120. And almost every single title that the Series X can play 4K 120, the Series S can play 1440, or 1080p 120. And a 4K Blu-ray player, as the Series S is a digital-only console and you are going to be limited to digital games. However, with Game Pass, that isn't a huge downside. However, if you have a Blu-ray movie collection or a past collection of games from the Xbox Original, 360, and Xbox One, you won't be able to play those. 8K resolution HDR high dynamic range can be achieved on the PlayStation 5 as well as the Series S. Now that is only going to be for streaming videos from platforms like Netflix and YouTube, as there is no way on this side of the Mississippi that these consoles can successfully push 8K gaming at a steady frame rate of anything higher than 24-30 at the highest. Xbox Velocity architecture. The Series S and X have the exact same operating system or software suite and share virtually all the same features such as quick resume. 1 terabyte solid state drive. It's actually a 512 in the Series S, which comes out to 364 gigabytes of usable space, which is real petite. That's not satisfying anybody, ladies. We all know that. But it is, in essence, the same solid state drive with the same read and write speed, so you are still getting the same load times on the Series S. And then VRR, or variable refresh rate, that is also on the Xbox Series S, as that is part of the Xbox Velocity architecture operating system. And what that does is dynamically changes resolution in the background. You might not even notice it to the naked eye. However, it is adjusting the resolution in highly graphically intensive scenes with a lot of explosions and movement on screen to keep that targeted frame rate of 120 or 60. Enough jaw jacking and lip smacking because these bad boys are getting chapped. Let's break into this box. That's what he said. Come here, big girl. So as I mentioned during the intro, this is officially the last console that I picked up for the 9th generation of home consoles. That was loud, little ASMR for you guys. Rip headphone users. I already own 2 PlayStation 5s. I have made a separate video explaining why I own 2 PS5s.
Why you ain't got a Series X, but you got 2 PS5s there, big dog?
There's always a method to daddy's madness. As always, Microsoft is reminding you to power your wet dreams. You gotta be smarter than the box there, big dog. You're a big girl and I like that. You can actually use these to get pet hair off your shirt when you're done unboxing your Xbox. Oh. Well, that's an immediate difference right there, because the unboxing experience of a Series S looks like you just bought a $20 pair of headphones from the flea market. It was just thrown in there with some egg carton and a couple of packing peanuts. This is a very premium unboxing experience and actually well exceeds what I got with the PlayStation 5. Again, that's just cardboard. This has some nice foam in here, a nice presentation, has your console wrapped up in this little condom here. I'm not gonna use that because I prefer to go raw, but it does remind you again, your dreams, power them. Put a little juice in the tank, power them up. You're gonna have a little quick start guide here showing you, hey, take the batteries out of your mom's vibrator and put them in the back of your controller. Yes, the Xbox Series S still uses disposables. I actually find this to be a good thing. I have made this statement in the past and I'll say it once again. You have the option to where you can get a rechargeable battery pack. They're about $20 on Amazon. One is linked down there in the description below. It comes with 2 batteries and a little dock. You can just hot swap those. But if for some reason one of those dies, you don't have to sit there for an hour charging your controller until it has enough juice to play. You can just grab some disposables. So that's kind of cool. Now in this box here, you are gonna have a high-speed HDMI cable. You want to make sure that you use the HDMI cable that came with the console. And if this is not long enough for your uses, I will have an HDMI 2.1 or high-speed cable linked in the description below. You don't wanna use some old HDMI cable from an old 720p DVD player or anything. It will not push 4K 120. I repeat, it will not push 4K 120. You need a TV that supports HDMI 2.1, and then you need the proper cable. There for you. You are going to have a power cable because this thing, I don't know if you knew this, it doesn't work without getting power to it. So you are going to need this power cable. You're going to have a product and regulatory guide. Don't know how to read, so that's getting tossed. You do have one controller. This is the same controller that comes with the Series S. The only difference is this is going to be black to match the console, just like the Series S is going to be white to match that console. Now, the only upgrades or changes from the Xbox One controller would be the addition of the share button. It's a feature that Sony had on the PlayStation 4, and I like that. Instead of having to press the Xbox button and then press either X to save a video clip or A to share a screenshot, you can just stay in game. Maybe you just bust out a 360 no scope or a hot slide cancel or a little Husker Du peekaroo around the corner or something and you want to save it, you can do that. Does come with two AA's, so your sister's happy toy can remain powered up. Don't have to steal from her. I believe that's it. Yeah, that's all it's in here. Now, if you plan on selling your console at a later date, I would recommend chucking the box and all the paperwork and all the included accessories in a closet or something, because that will increase your resale value a little bit. Me personally, you would have to pry this console out of my cold, dead hands. They just peel you like a banana, sweetheart. Okay, so very handsome looking console. Now, I will say, I really wish what was sitting in front of me on the table here was the Halo 20th Anniversary Edition console. I think that looks phenomenal. But I will say, the standard Vanilla Bean Missionary Position console actually looks very, very, very good in my opinion. I think both of the new generation consoles have their cosmetic appeal. I will say the Series X is gonna go with more people's living room setups. Why? Well, it comes in a nice flat matte black in comparison to the reverse Oreo design of the PS5. Granted, I've customized both of mine. Pictures on screen here. This is not only going to look visually more appealing in a lot of people's entertainment centers, but it's also going to fit in a lot more entertainment centers considering it is not nearly as long. You can of course have this bad boy in vertical orientation, or it does also have rubberized pads where you can set it horizontally. Now I'm going to do that right now so I can show you this exhaust port up here. This is the exhaust port, and it is freakishly quiet on the Series X and the Series S. The Series S is a skosh more quiet. I don't have the exact decibel difference, but just know to the human ear, it is slightly quieter, but the Series X is also very quiet. The PS5, not so much. During updates, startup, and shutdown, it does spool up a little bit and gets a little bit noisy, but nowhere near the PS4 and Xbox One of the last generation. You do also have some lime green inside of these exhaust ports, which I think is just a really cool little Microsoft touch. You have your disc eject button, a USB 2.0 port, the controller pairing button, and then of course the power button. Small emblazed Xbox logo over here. You do have a rubberized stand on the bottom. And as for the rump or tuchus of the console, you have your storage expansion. This is for the Seagate 1 terabyte memory stick that does retail for $220 US, which is pretty steep, but I do like that it is modular and just plug and play. So you can swap that from a Series X to a Series S. Maybe you go to your buddy's house and you want to bring all your games over. You can just do that as opposed to the PS5. You have to pop off the side panel and install an NVMe SSD, which does also have its perks, but ease of use is not one of them. You do have your power plug. You do have your HDMI 2.1 out to your TV. You do have two USB 3.0 ports, and you do have an Ethernet port that is rated for gigabit Ethernet. I'll see you in the living room. I mean, as long as you keep watching the video, I'll see you in the living room. Before you unplug an Xbox Series S or X from the wall, you want to go into general, then general sleep mode and startup, then down to full shutdown, as where if you just hold down the Xbox button and hit shutdown, that is not completely shutting down your console. I took this opportunity to pull my Xbox Series S out and clean underneath it. It hadn't been dusted in quite some time, and my little Harley girl, she sheds a lot. Also, a quick note, the Series S and X do not have the same HDMI cable, and the Series S cable will not push 4K 120 because the console is not capable of it, so please use your Xbox Series X cable. Now, I did buy this as a bundle at the Navy Exchange with a controller and a game. The controller I'm most likely gonna customize or give away because, well, I'm not wild about this controller, but all they had was plain white, plain black, and then this bad boy, so I'm probably gonna give this away or customize it and then give it away. And then a big stinky stinker. I forgot my clothespin for the nose, but we have a Call of Duty Vanguard over here, which I said multiple times on my Facebook gaming page and also on YouTube, that I simply wasn't going to get this game because, well, quite simply, it's going to be the worst Call of Duty title in several years. I must have been staring into my crystal balls or something because that statement ended up being true. I'm not going to document this whole process here because, well, the console's been out for over a year and there's people that got the consoles early, so you've probably seen the setup process. But I will say real quick, I do like that since the console is quite a bit bigger than the Series S, it completely blocks that green LED cube that I have back there. So you just get that green glow from behind the console, and I think that looks awesome. Now do keep in mind though that we leave nothing stock here at Gamer Heaven. I don't know why I'm power stancing like this on you, but it's most likely gonna get a full decal or vinyl wrap, or might even disassemble and hydro dip it. Not sure about that just yet. Maybe we'll go water cooled. All right, Stallion, so I did the initial setup, but a couple of settings that you wanna change immediately. In case you don't know about these, they are incredibly important. So first of all, over here in network, you can change your Wi-Fi bands from 2.4 gigahertz to 5 gigahertz. You will get higher peak speeds with 5. However, you will get more consistency. And if you are very far from your router and you're not plugged up via Ethernet, maybe your modem slash routers in an office and you're all the way in a bedroom or a living room, 2.4 gigahertz might be the best option for you, or you can just leave it in automatic and it will dynamically switch back and forth in the background. The next one over here in TV and display options, by default, as you can see, even though it does its little system optimization when you first hook it up to your TV, this is going to be defaulted at 60 hertz. Why, baby Jesus, why? 120 hertz, please. Let it kick in here. Yes, I would like that. There we go. Even with the Series S, you will see the option for 4K, and I would recommend selecting that. Obviously, for games on the Series S, it will be 1440, and then 4K in a lot of titles for the Series X. Now, I do also recommend that you go through your television settings and optimize your HDR settings for your TV, along with the HDR settings of your new console. And keep in mind that a lot of modern TVs have different settings for each HDMI port. So if you ever change ports, make sure that the same settings are on that port as well. Over here in video modes under advanced, you want to make sure that all these are selected except for allow YCC. Dolby Vision for gaming is off. I'm going to check that because this TV is a 75 inch LG and it does support Dolby Vision. So I do want to make sure that that is enabled as well. Get the most graphical fidelity out of this 12.1 teraflops of juice. Now, one thing I notice immediately is that the home menu actually looks a little bit more crisp than the Series S, and that is because the Series S actually displays the home menu at 1080p. So when you're looking at a 75 or even larger TV, you'll see little pixelation around the outsides of boxes and letters. As we're here on the Series X, it looks a lot crisper. But other than that, this operating system is virtually identical to the Series S, and moreover than that, it's almost identical to an Xbox One. That's kind of good and bad. That's good because there's zero learning curve. You just feel like you're on your old Xbox One. But it doesn't really give you that next generation experience like you got with the PS5, where it's a brand new operating system with a whole nother toolbar at the bottom, you know, new features. To me personally, I feel like if you spend $500 on a new console and you enter the next console generation and you even bought a new TV to support that experience, you kind of want the user interface, the operating system, to go with it.
I've now moved my Xbox Series S into the bedroom, which I think goes more with the aesthetic, the white furniture that I have in that room. And now I can stream Xbox games on the PC, play them in the living room on the Series X, and continue them on the Series S in the bedroom, which is awesome. So after owning the Xbox Series S for over a year and having the Series X for about 3 days, where I have gotten a lot of stick time with it, here's my consensus. The general experience and operating system is identical to the Series S. You're still gonna get lightning fast boot times, load times in game, switching levels, etc., due to that solid state drive or SSD. You're also going to get 120 frames per second gaming. It didn't look any more fluid than on the Series S because, well, it's not. It's still at 120 hertz. But what you do notice is three major improvements over the Series S. That $200 gets you a couple of very notable features. The first one is a 4K Ultra HD Blu-ray drive, which is fantastic because you can slide in a good portion of the past Microsoft library. Xbox original 360 and 1 games, you slide them in that disc slot, and 90% of the time, it will install them, boot them up, no problem. Also, if you have a Blu-ray movie collection and you don't own another Blu-ray playing device, then this is a great option for you. The next one, I don't hear a lot of tech reviewers and gaming YouTube channels mentioning this. However, the storage is a big deal, considering you only have 364 gigabytes of usable space on a Series S. And in 2021, or 22, I guess I should say, that is like three AAA titles with some DLC and a couple of map packs. So you are gonna need to buy that Seagate 1 terabyte expandable storage slot. Now, that is $220 US, which is more than two-thirds the price of the Series S. So if you factor that in, you might as well have just got a Series X considering you have a terabyte. Granted, it goes down to about 825 gigabytes of usable space, enough to stash a decent amount of games. Now, with the Series S or Series X, you can just plug in an external hard drive, which you can get for like 50, 60 bucks on Amazon. However, you will only be able to install classic games on there, so Xbox One and older. If you play a game that is optimized for the Series S and X, you will get prompted to transfer that over to your internal storage. Last but not least would be the sheer graphical graphical fidelity is a noticeable difference. I played several titles that I had played through and beaten on the Series S, such as the Master Chief Collection, Halo Infinite, Gears 5, Titanfall 2, Forza Horizon, and the Medium. And the Medium was actually released during the S and X era, so it is specifically for those consoles, and it was built with those in mind. Now, I will say, there was a lot of texture pop-in, muddy textures, wonky draw distances on the Series S. Those were not present in the Series X because you have three times the graphical power. So if you don't have a PC, or you do have an old family computer or a laptop or something, this is going to be a lot more powerful. You cannot build a PC for $500 that'll hit 4K 120, so this is an absolute fantastic option if you want the best graphics for this console generation. But even if graphics aren't that important to you, the fact that you are eventually going to have to upgrade the storage in the Series S, and the Series X already comes with a fair amount of storage, that in combination with having a disc slot where you do have the option of owning physical assets that when you're done beating the game, you can sell them or trade them into GameStop, that alone is worth the $200 considering you're most likely going to have this Series X console for 5 to 7 years. So in my opinion, I do believe the Series X is a better option for most gamers, for most people watching this video. However, the Series S is still a fantastic option I would recommend for a couple of niche buyers. The first one would be people that are trying to emulate retro consoles, considering even the hard to emulate consoles like Dreamcast, N64 will run just fine on 4 teraflops. So you can engage what's called developer mode, and the Series S is a nice little emulation machine. Yes, you can do all that on the Series X, but why pay $500 if you're just playing classic games? The next one would be if you're buying this as a second console, which is technically now my use for it as it is in the bedroom. So I can play a game on my PC, on the Series X, and then before bed, I can play it on the Series S. And if you're on Game Pass, all your save progress is stored in the cloud and it transfers over, including all your settings, which is great. The next one would be if you are on a budget. Now, Microsoft does offer a payment plan, but with interest, you will end up paying more over time. PlayStation does not offer that, neither does Nintendo. So Microsoft is the only one that has a payment plan. It is bundled with Game Pass. So technically you get Game Pass, so a huge library of good AAA games, and you pay, I believe it's like $20 a month for the console. But even $300 up front, which not to mention I'm starting to see used Series S's for under recommended retail, so around $280 or so, because a lot of people bought this as a placeholder until they could get a Series X or PS5, and I'm starting to see Series S's on Craigslist and Facebook Marketplace for about $280 or so. That would be a great budget console, as it is a huge generational leap with the SSD and 120 hertz gaming. But in my opinion, if you do not have a PC, the Series X is the one console to own, as you are going to have a more vast library of next generation games that can hit 120 hertz. Now, if you're a diehard Sony fan and you enjoy the exclusives, as PlayStation does produce some amazing in-house Sony Interactive Entertainment games such as Ratchet and Clank, God of War, Spider-Man, Gran Turismo, Last of Us, Uncharted series, just to name a few, there's a bunch more, then obviously you're going to want to pick yourself up a PS5 as well. And then if you like on-the-go gaming, you'll probably pick up either a Valve Steam Deck or a Nintendo Switch. However, if you just want or can only afford one console, because it is the most versatile, like I mentioned, you can engage developer mode and make it an emulation retro powerhouse. You have a disc player to play all your old games and movies. You have a decent amount of storage, more than the PlayStation 5 or Series S. And when bundled with Game Pass, you have an awesome library of games, both classic games that have had their frame rate doubled from 30 to 60 or 60 to 120, as well as AAA new release games such as Starfield, any new Fallout or Skyrim, basically any Microsoft or Bethesda game is going to be launched day and date on Game Pass, which is really cool. For example, I played the hell out of Halo Infinite, didn't spend 60, 70 bucks for it. It was just part of Game Pass. Also, another little thing to note, you can plug in a keyboard and mouse into this bad boy and use it basically as a PC. There are actually third-party programs or plugins you can use that give you basically a full-blown browser and everything, to where you could actually use this thing as a PC as well, which it kind of looks like a little gaming PC, and you are going to get astronomically good performance for the price. So overall, 10 out of 10 would recommend. I think this is a fantastic console, and I am in no way let down by owning it. Now, I will say, if I did not have a YouTube channel, would I own all of these consoles? No, probably not. The Series X is the one console I wouldn't get because I have a very high-end PC with a 3080 in it, and Game Pass is on the PC, so I would have kept my Series S, because if I wanted to casually play Xbox games in the living room, that's what the Series S is for. So just because I personally would not own this console unless I had a YouTube channel, that shouldn't sway your opinion or your decision making whatsoever, because at the end of the day, that big green giant, well, that big black sucker with the green tip, that was weird, is a great, great console. Drop in the comment section below, i.e. the stable where the stallions and stallionettes trot around, your opinion of the Xbox Series X and S for that matter. We'll get a little conversation, a little forum going on down there. If you enjoyed this honest console review, liking the video will help it to get seen by more gamers. This information will reach and assist them as well. Subscribe for more content like this. I cover news in the gaming community and industry, as well as tutorials helping you get set up streaming and YouTubing, and honest gaming peripheral reviews, keyboards, mice, headsets, controllers, mics, mics, chairs, etc. And I'll see you tomorrow. Peace.